Make hay while the sun is still shining. When the winter time comes, it may be too difficult, right? So immerse yourself in practice now. Don't wait. Don't wait. I'm doing this, you know, before breakfast. Say, no, work before you eat. It's like on a farm, you get up and do your chores, and then you eat. So, immersion in practice is the right way. It is the right way. Just keep that in mind. And we have a great practice for you today. I've already gone through it this morning. I tested it out, and I'm in the wow phase of it a little bit here. Very much, actually, wow. Remember, our practice has three aspects to it. The assertions, full stop in the wow, and flipping the script. Flipping the script is more like talking, dialogue, brainstorming, sorting it through in your mind. And then assertions are making these statements, assertions. And then the wow is managing your success. When you have these breakthroughs, you just put it in neutral and coast a little bit. So we have the tools that we need, actually. And we have the practices that we need. They keep getting better and better and better. And the results are being glimpsed. And that's like a wow. Very much so. When you do these practices, you will find the momentum of this. It will enable you to get glimpses of what is possible. And when you see that, you will just be momentarily a little bit stunned. You mean I don't need the suffering? Right, I don't need suffering. I don't need this? I can see I don't really need this. Okay, so It's not boring at all. It's the opposite of boring. It's worldly activity is what's boring, actually. Bores us to death. But this, glimpsing your freedom from misery and suffering and death and all the things that you hate so much, awkwardness, non-support, vulnerability, seeing that you actually, there, yes, I can be free of that. I don't need it. How is that boring? That is the opposite of boring. It's so intense that you need to sit quietly just to preemptively contain the intensity of it. Okay. We have enough free space here to go. So, this morning I was doing a practice, and it expanded into greater intensity, greater effectiveness than ever before. So we're going to take a look at this. If we can. If we can say this, the most difficult, greatest difficulty in the world is bringing through these practices. Talked about non-dual abidance, which is our goal, or abidance in this state of complete support. We don't need any results, we don't need any successes, we don't need any attainments. So what we do is we practice saying this. Keep in mind that what this world is simply dream simulation to give us opportunity to engage in a dress rehearsal for what we think is going to be the kingdom of time. And also keep in mind, there is never going to be any kingdom of time. So this is all aimless, completely aimless, completely meaningless. But we can give this dream a different purpose. This is what our basic premise is. So when we give this dream a different purpose, it's the purpose of preparing us to realize that time will never start. There'll never be any kingdom. We don't need to prepare at all. In reality, there's no such concepts as success or attainment or results or accomplishments, because there's no possibility, there's no need for any of that. It's all perfect, inherently flawless and perfect. There's no need to prepare for something different than what reality is, okay? So, what we really need to practice is this abidance, and we can do this, actually. We can do this. I did it this morning. And we use this agree with your adversary quickly technique. Say, yes, yes, I don't need any results. Yes, I don't have any results whatsoever. I'm completely free of all results. I have absolutely no attainment whatsoever. Yes, I have absolutely no achievements whatsoever. I'm completely free of all achievements. Yes, I have no achievements. Yes, I have no attainments. Yes, I have no accomplishments. Yes, I have no accomplishments. Yes, I have absolutely no results. I have no results. Yes, I have no results. Now, the ego, which is arrogance, the voice of arrogance, will try to bully and intimidate you into thinking you need results. I mean, you have to get results. And you just agree, oh yes, I have to get results. But then we go back to practicing. Yes, I have no results. I have absolutely no results. I am completely without any success. Yes, I am completely without any success. Now, this is like taking a chainsaw to a tree, and it's just like, wow, cutting right through it. The tree of our arrogance. The tree that bears the bad fruit of believing in attainment and achievement. And all of attainment, achievement, accomplishment, results, success, all of that has to do with getting ready for time. Okay, we don't need any of that at all in reality. Reality is totally supportive of us, completely supportive of us. I don't need any awkwardness. See, awkwardness is our preparation for time. And what is more awkward than the body, you see? The body is just a tool for awkwardness and results and achievements and successes. But it's successes in trying to deal with this awkwardness. Just this whole world is actually awkward. I don't even need this world. I don't have any world at all. We can say this. In experiencing this abidance in non-duality, it's more like there's this presence of a perfect continuum, and the presence is equal everywhere. It's not really like a world. There's no awkwardness at all. There's no adjustments. I have no adjustments at all. I'm completely free of all adjustments. Yes, I'm completely free of all adjustments. Yes, I'm completely free of all attainment. I'm devoid of any attainment whatsoever. I have absolutely zero accomplishments. Yes, I have absolutely zero accomplishments. Yes, I don't have any adjustments. I've made absolutely no adjustments. Yes, I'm completely devoid of all success. Yes, I've never arrived anywhere. Yes, I've never accomplished anything. Yes, I've never had any success. I am completely free of success. Yes, I am completely free of accomplishments. Yes, I am completely free of attainments. Yes, I am completely free of achievements. Yes, I am completely free of all results. Double check to make sure the microphone is the right one. Okay, it is. Great. Now, this is all shocking, of course. We're not used to thinking in this way, but all of these qualities that we think we need, that those are actually qualities that we think we need in time, in the kingdom of time. And we're asserting there isn't ever going to be any kingdom of time. So I certainly don't need any success at all. And in this a new purpose for this dream, I'm preparing for the kingdom of now. In the kingdom of now, there's no success there at all. There's no achievement. There's no accomplishment. There's no attainments. There's no arrivals. There's no getting. There's no results. Because I'm perfectly supported. There's perfect support for me. And the support is so perfect. This is what we need to start getting to. The support is so perfect that I don't feel any awkwardness whatsoever. So I don't even feel any body whatsoever. See, the body is, what is the body? Discomfort, awkwardness, right? Body never feels completely right. There's always some ache, some pain, always having to orient ourselves, keep our balance, move, eat. It's nonstop concern, isn't it? It's a picture of a lack of support. It's a picture of what we believe time would be. But preparing for the kingdom of now, we feel perfect supportiveness. There's not even an iota of awkwardness or out-of-placeness or striving or stress or need to attain or accomplish or learn or achieve or get results. Struggling against some awkward situation. The support is so perfect that we feel like effortlessly, not even floating. It's even beyond floating. They call it bliss. We feel bliss. Feel blissful. This is the perfect support of the kingdom of the now. We're preparing for the kingdom of now. So we leave behind the preparation for the kingdom of time, which can never be or never start. There's no such thing as time. There is no lack of freedom. There are no restrictions on our true freedom, spiritual freedom. Except we cannot change this fact. That there are no restrictions. We can't use our freedom to change freedom. That's the only restriction that we have. So, preparing for the kingdom of now, we don't need to feel the body, the awkwardness of it at all. We don't need to feel the awkwardness of striving for attainments, accomplishments, achievements, results. We're free of all that success. We don't need it. We don't have any success. We don't need to. We're completely supported. So this is just the introduction of this very powerful practice. And we give ourselves time to get over the shock of the introduction. Yes, I don't have any success. Yes, I am free of success. Now, the trouble that we all have, but that can be resolved for us, is we think that this is like maybe counterintuitive, but what we don't realize is that we've given the dream a different purpose. The purpose of preparing us for the kingdom of now, for time to never start. So it's totally in line with this new purpose. If we don't realize that we've given the dream a different purpose, then it sounds counterintuitive, because we think we have to successfully prepare for the kingdom of time. So we need these accomplishments and achievements. We need to overcome the awkwardness. We need to find clever ways to deal with the awkwardness and of time, what we believe time would be like. But if we give the dream a different purpose, we don't need to do that. We can just simply not have any awkwardness, not have any success. See, success, the counterpart of success is failure. Success really, it means avoiding failure. And achievement means avoiding non-achievement. You somehow manage to avoid, you know, some awkwardness. So you say, oh, yeah, I have this accomplishment. I have a nice car. I've avoided the awkwardness of having a car that is not so nice. Whereas in this dream now of preparing us for the kingdom of now, there isn't any awkwardness. There's just perfect support. So this practice is not counterintuitive. It's entirely intuitive. It's entirely aligned with this new purpose that we have given the dream. So I have no success whatsoever. I'm completely free of all success. It's very important to practice with these positives that we think are so important to prepare for time. It's these positives that are binding us to preparation for time. Okay, so we need to drop these positives and recognize that the real positive now is to be free of all that. The attachment to time, preparing for time. So I'm completely free of all achievements. I have absolutely no achievements whatsoever. I'm absolutely free of any accomplishment. I have no accomplishments. I'm free of all accomplishments. Now, when we do these practices, we might, at some point, as I did, see that I don't need the body, actually. Ultimately, we don't need the body at all. The body is just a device to prepare us for time of awkwardness and lack of support and lack of perfect support. So when we're experiencing perfect support and we're used to that, we don't need a body at all. We can keep a body for a communication device, but it will function. It will not feel awkward to us in the slightest bit. We don't need the feeling of sickness, awkwardness, any of that. So these practices bring us very close to this shift in how we experience the body. Jesus tells us we won't feel anything at all, neither positive nor negative. Just a lack of any awkwardness, a lack of any achievements, success, accomplishment. Ability. I don't have any abilities at all. There's another A. Yes. Yes, I already know. I am completely free of all abilities. Yes, I already know. I don't have any abilities. Who needs abilities when you have perfect support? Yes, I already know I'm completely free of all abilities. I have no abilities. Yes, I already know I'm completely free of all achievements. I have no achievements. Yes, I already know I'm completely free of all attainment. I have no attainment. This practice hits very hard, but that's what we want. That's what we want. So the wow is very strong, very stunning, but that's good. And it's a whole different level. Lying in bed doing this silently is one thing, and then doing this, vocalizing this and sharing with the world has a whole different level of intensity. This is like very stunning. Because nobody talks this way. You see, this is the problem that we have. Nobody, this kind of practice never gets through here. Almost never gets through here. So we live in this incredible impoverishment. I am completely free of all success. I have absolutely no success whatsoever. Yes. I completely accept that I have no success whatsoever. Funny, yesterday I went and got a new chainsaw blade. For a 16-inch chainsaw, and today this practice is like a new chainsaw blade. I mean, cutting the tree of arrogance down goes right through it. Yes, I have absolutely no accomplishments whatsoever. I'm completely free of all accomplishments. I don't even know what accomplishments are. Yes, I have no idea what accomplishments are. Yes, I have no idea what success is. I have no successes at all. Success is completely meaningless to me. Accomplishment is completely aimless and meaningless to me. Yes. Attainment is completely meaningless to me. Yes, I have absolutely no stability. I have no stability, no accomplishments, no attainments, no results, no success. No results. I'm completely free of any results. I'm completely free of any success. I have no awareness of results. I have no awareness of accomplishments. I have no awareness of achievements. I have no awareness of success. Yes, I have no awareness of success. Now, full stop in the wow. This is how we practice, because these practices are very intense. And the forest of arrogance is being felled by this. And the landscape is changing rapidly before our eyes. So we have to practice this full stop in the wow. Just sit quietly like this. Very stunning. To celebrate in a positive affirmation, assertion. Like, this is great. I have no accomplishments at all. This is great. You see, we're so unused to that. That is just truly an astonishment. Yes, I have no abilities whatsoever. I have no abilities whatsoever. Now, this may feel like running up a steep hill. Well, it is like that. But that's good, because you get to the top of the hill and you look around and you say, wow, look at the view. Yes, I know. I don't even need a body. I don't need a body. I don't need awkwardness. I don't have any awkwardness. I don't know what awkwardness is. I don't know what accomplishment is. I have no accomplishments. I celebrate having no accomplishments whatsoever. I celebrate not knowing any accomplishment. I celebrate not having any attainment. So if you want to know what real meditation is, real practice, this is it. I can feel this just very intense. Wow. Yes, I have no abilities. Yes, I have no abilities. Now the ego will say, if you don't have any abilities, you're going to die. And you disagree with the ego. Yes, if I don't have any abilities, I'm going to die. What the ego's really concerned about, though, is you'll realize you don't need a body. You don't need a body. You don't need the awkwardness of birth, growth, sustaining, and aging, and death. You don't need any of that awkwardness. None of it. And this is the ego's, chosen idol, the body. So it's very important to prepare for time, to believe you have a body. In fact, it's essential. You really can't prepare for time without a body. So anything that undermines, your belief that you need a body, the ego is just freaked out about it. Keep in mind, the body is just a dream symbol. This is all just a dream. We can change the dream. We can have a dream where we don't need a body. We can have a light body, we don't need this heavy, sick, dense, awkwardness body at all. So to the ego, this is just the ultimate heresy, this practice. Yes, I have no achievements. And we can feel when the wow tends to lessen a little bit. So these shockwaves hit us and we say, wow, we're really going contrary to what the ego tells us we have to do, right? Wow, what we have to believe. So I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I lack any result whatsoever. I have no results. I'm result free. Here's another one. It's very important. I have no answers. I'm answer free. I'd forgotten that one because it's so potent. Wow. Okay. Yes, I don't have any answers. And just saying that triggered a huge wow. Yes, I don't have any answers. I have absolutely no answers whatsoever. Yes, I have absolutely no answers whatsoever. Now I'm having flashbacks to when I was younger, and the striving of egoic purpose, striving for prepare for time was not so ingrained. You see, I'm starting flashbacks. And you can say not even younger, but when my mind was not so attached to any answers at all. So there was less identification with any awkwardness. It did not produce awkwardness. Yes, I have no answers whatsoever. And perfect support, of course. What answers do you need? You don't need any answers. There's no questions about lack of support. Like, what do I do if I have lack of support? I need an answer for that. There is no question about that whatsoever. And we can experience this perfect support by changing the purpose of this dream simulation. Since God had nothing to do with this dream simulation, we're completely free to change the purpose of it. Now, arrogance tells us that God did all this. created this world, created bodies, created nature, put us here, and told us this is where we can find our happiness and need to make homes and build roads and cars and till the earth and all this stuff. That's arrogance. That's egoic arrogance that's telling us that. God is not that way at all. God just gives us absolute freedom. And what we do with that freedom is our choice. Now we can co-create with God in terms of extending that freedom. Absolutely, that's what we do. But we're extending freedom. God is not the architect of worlds and universes. He's not some planner, designer that has some script that we have to follow. There's no roles we have to act out at all in order to please God. No, we just have this absolute freedom. So, there are no answers. I have no answers because there's no questions. I have no abilities because there's no need. There's no disability. I have no accomplishments because there's no failure. Yes, I already know that I already have no answers. I already have no answers. I already have no success. I have zero success. Zero. No need to count it because there isn't any. I don't have any answers. Zero answers. Now, in practicing like this, you'll feel stress, and you might feel tired and sluggish and shocked, stunned. But it wears off after a little while. This is the price we pay. So I just have to tolerate it. I have no abilities. Yes, I already know. I have absolutely no abilities whatsoever. I have absolutely no enlightenment. I have absolutely no enlightenment whatsoever. I have no solutions whatsoever. I have no answers whatsoever. None. I have no enlightenment, no answers, no realizations, no attainments, no accomplishments, no success, no achievements, no arrivals, no results. I have no enlightenment whatsoever. This is turning things around. What we hear often that they say, well, there's enlightenment, but just nobody there to be enlightened. But actually, the way I'm seeing it right now is there is an I. I mean, we do have, when we give a different purpose to this dream, there still seems to be an identity. We still have an identity. It's just that there is no enlightenment. It's not that we're enlightened, but there's no I. It's that there's I, but there's no enlightenment. There's I, but there's no answers. There's I, but there's no success. Don't need it, because the I is preparing for the kingdom of now, which is, and the kingdom of now is completely supportive. So there's no need, question for enlightenment. What there's no unenlightenment. Unenlightenment is impossible. So how can it be enlightenment? So enlightenment is still a very dualistic concept. So we abide in non-dualism. There's no attainment in non-dualism. In the kingdom of perfect supportiveness, how can we talk of attainment? There's no lack of support at all. So I don't have any enlightenment whatsoever. I'm enlightenment free. I don't have any realization whatsoever. I'm realization free. I don't have any attainment whatsoever. I'm attainment free. I have no awakening. I'm awakening free. I don't have any awakening whatsoever. I'm not awake. I don't have any awakening. I'm just experiencing this perfect supportiveness. Not a shred of awkwardness. I don't have any awkwardness. And therefore no need to awake from any awkwardness, or be in an awake state where I'm, you know, counteracting the awkwardness. I don't have any awakenness. I don't have any attainment. I don't have any realization. I don't have any enlightenment. So this absolutely cuts to the core. And yet we can do it. I have no attainment whatsoever. Totally, I'm totally free of all attainment. I have no enlightenment whatsoever. I'm totally free of any enlightenment. I have no answers whatsoever. I'm totally free of all answers. Just simply, I am. See, just abide in I am. That's it. Not I am awake. I don't have any awakeness at all. Just I am. The totally supported, the total perfect supportiveness of I am. I have no idea of enlightenment. I have no idea of attainment. I have no notion of accomplishment. I have no notion of realization. I have no idea about finishing. I have no idea about progress. I have no idea about attainment. I have no idea about accomplishment. I don't have any answers. I don't have any success. I don't have any answers. I don't have any success. I'm empty of all attainment. I'm empty of any accomplishment. I'm empty of any success. I'm empty of any enlightenment. Now keep in mind that we're practicing this. This is not some theoretical discussion. We're practicing this. We have faith that this is so, that we can give a different purpose to the dream. Okay, this is based on our faith that we can give a different purpose to this dream. That God is not dreaming this dream for us. We're the dreamer. Spirit is dreaming this dream of this simulated dress rehearsal for time. This gives us the opportunity to rehearse for what we think is a kingdom of time. God has nothing to do with this. So that we have faith in this as our basic premise. Otherwise, how could we practice this way? We would get all conflicted. I'm not feeling any conflict. I'm feeling a tremendous wow. See, I'm free of all awakening. I'm free of all attainment. I'm free of the necessity for awakening. I'm free of any necessity for attainment. I'm free of any necessity for accomplishment. I'm free of any necessity for awkwardness. I'm free of any necessity to arrive anywhere. I'm free of any necessity for any answers. The cat is always hurrying somewhere. Like it's very preoccupied with having to get somewhere. But is it getting anywhere? No, it's just wandering around. But it acts like it's wandering around. It's like super important. I'm free of any needs. I don't have any needs. I don't have any success. I'm absolutely free of any success. So this is like taking our medicine. Wonderful. I love doing this. I love this type of practice. Thank you, Holy Spirit. This is tremendous. I have no achievements. I've never achieved anything. I have no idea what achievement is. I have no idea what accomplishment is. I have no idea what enlightenment is. I have no idea what success is. I have no idea what attainment is. I have no idea what awkwardness is. I have no idea what awkwardness is. I have no idea what awkwardness is. I have no idea what success is. There is no success. I have no success. Success doesn't exist. Accomplishments don't exist. Attainments don't exist. Recognitions don't exist. Enlightenment doesn't exist. Arrival doesn't exist. Answers don't exist. Results don't exist. Success doesn't exist. I don't know any success because success doesn't exist. practicing this way is so powerful. It bypasses so much of the ego's defensiveness and distraction and misdirection. I don't have any direction. I don't have any aim. I don't have any aim whatsoever. I don't have any accomplishment whatsoever. I don't have any answers. I don't even know what answers are. The term answers is meaningless to me. Completely meaningless. I don't have any answers. Okay, so when I'm going to stay in the stunness, full stop in the wow. I should easily be able to just sit quietly. I'm going to take care of something here for just a moment now. I'll be right back. Absolutely have no answers whatsoever. I'm completely free of answers. Now, this practice is absolutely no attainment. Okay? I have absolutely no attainment. This practice is the most powerful one we've ever done, for sure. But we need this. Absolutely need it. So, part of the problem we have is we think that there's no practice that will ultimately, you know, that we can immerse ourselves in and so we don't even try. But now we see that there is a practice that we can immerse ourselves in that does serve as like a bridge into the new purpose. See, we have a new purpose for the stream. We need to practice getting used to this new purpose, which is this total supportiveness, feeling totally supported, an entire universe of absolute support for us. Imagine this, that there's an entire universe whose only purpose is to be perfectly supportive to us and not produce the slightest bit of awkwardness or insecurity in us whatsoever, that we absolutely can do no wrong at all. We cannot be awkward or uncomfortable in the slightest bit. An entire universe that completely dedicated to being perfectly supportive of us without us having to do anything to earn any such support or attain it or achieve it or accomplish it. Inherent, fundamentally inherent, given support, freely given, graciously given, blissfully given, given with gratitude. So yes, I am completely free of all attainment. I wash the dust of attainment off my feet. I wash the dust of success off of my feet. See, people come to the gurus and they say, oh, let me touch your feet, let me touch your feet. And they say, I want to get the dust of success off of your feet. And then they try to turn that into success. You know, they should be practicing. I have absolutely no success. I'm completely free of all success. I wash the dust of success off of my feet. I washed the dust of attainment off of my feet. I have no attainment. I'm completely free of all attainments. Well, this is what Jesus is saying, is blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall inherit the kingdom. Kingdom of now. Poor in spirit, meaning I have no attainments. I have no accomplishments. I have no success. This is what Jesus is getting at. He who would lose his life for my sake shall gain eternal life. He who tries to keep his life shall lose it. And he who will lose his life for my sake shall gain eternal life. Right? This is what he's saying. I have no attainment. I have no success. I have no achievements. That's what he means by quote-unquote life. Our attempt to, you know, what we call life here is this effort to prepare for time, trying to gain accomplishments, achievements, and we think that makes our spirit rich. You know, we're enriched with attainments and accomplishments and learning. But Jesus says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall inherit the kingdom. Kingdom of now. Where is the kingdom now? It's right here. When is it? It's right now. How do we experience it? Change the purpose of this dream. And instead, the dream now is preparing us to drop all preparations. Preparing us to abide in the kingdom of now. Kingdom of I am. Isness. So, I wash the dust of all attainment from my feet. I have no attainment. I am attainment free, no attainment whatsoever. I am not the highest guru. I am not the highest God. I am not the highest anything. I have no attainment. Absolutely no attainment. I have no accomplishments. I have no abilities. I have no awareness. I have no recognition. I have no enlightenment. I have no levels. See, all of that is conceptual duality. That's all trying to be this big shot, rich spirit. But blessed are the poor in spirit. I mean, I don't have anything. I don't have anything. Yes, I already know. I don't have anything. I don't have any accomplishments. I don't have any attainments. I don't have any enlightenment. I don't have anything. Now, does that produce a paradoxical void? Not at all. Because in the kingdom of now, there aren't any things. There's just the play of pure potential, you see, that cannot be conceptualized at all. So in terms of concepts, we must wash the dust of concepts off of our feet. I don't have any enlightenment. I don't have any abilities. I have no success whatsoever. I don't have any success. I have nothing. There's nothing that I have. I don't have anything. I'm nothing. I'm nowhere. I don't have any place. I don't have any accomplishment. So you want your practices to bring about this wow. You don't want it just to be boring. You know, this is not boring. This is like incredibly intense. Or amazingly intense. Astonishingly intense. Now the ego will pretend to be all confused and say, wait a minute, I don't understand. Well, the ego doesn't understand that we can give a different purpose to this dream. The ego insists we can't. The ego insists that this dream was created by God. The ego created by our arrogance, and that we can't give it a new purpose because we've arrogated that we can't. Well, what is our arrogance? It's nothing. Is that the will of God, or is our arrogance the will of God? No, it isn't. Will of God is that we're free. So we're absolutely free to give this dream a new purpose. Now, the ego can't understand that. So it cannot understand when we say, you know, I have no practice, I have no success whatsoever, I'm free of success. You know, it's conflicting to the ego. It's conflicting. It says, wait a minute, you know. But it's not conflicting with the new purpose that we have at all. So the ego is a terrible advisor. It cannot advise you properly. It will never tell you how to practice properly. It will always guide you towards some sort of success. I have no success. I have no abilities whatsoever. I haven't achieved anything. I have no achievements. There's nothing for me to achieve. I don't have any need for enlightenment. What do you mean enlightenment? I don't have any need for enlightenment. There's nothing to be enlightened. There's nothing to be accomplished. I don't have a need for any accomplishments. There's nothing to be accomplished. This relates to the new purpose. This is not a fixing of the dream of time, or preparing for the dream of preparing for time. We're not fixing it at all. We're choosing a new purpose for the dream. We're not having a dream of time and being enlightened in that dream at all. That is the ego's goal. See, to divert us from choosing a new purpose for the dream. So this is the great genius of Jesus. He tells us, don't make illusions real and then try to deal with them or accommodate, get rid of them, get used to them, be happy with it. No, choose a different purpose for the dream. This is the way. The ego will never tell you that way. It will frantically try to prevent you from focusing on this way. I have no success. Success is impossible for me. Accomplishment is impossible for me. Attainment is impossible for me. See, this is true, right? It's not. How can I am, which is absolutely perfect, claim to have attained something? Did it attain perfection? Did it attain what it is? No, it was created as it is. yes, I cannot attain any success. Yes, I cannot attain any enlightenment. Yes, I cannot attain any truth. We can even say that. Yes, I cannot attain any knowledge. Yes, I cannot attain any goodness. Yes, I cannot attain any peace. Yes, I cannot attain any bliss. I cannot attain any reality. I have no accomplishments. I have no attainments. I cannot attain to anything. Now, the shock of this is so strong, because this is the kind of teaching I've been looking for my whole life. So it's like, wow, I'm hearing it now. This is tremendous. This is what I wanted to hear, but I came into this world and there's all these so-called spiritual teachers and everybody's following them. And they're just teaching, basically, most of them, just the ego. The ego's goal. You don't hear what you need to hear in this world. Didn't hear it. I didn't hear it. Where is it? I heard it in Jesus and in A Course in Miracles. I said, it's there. And he's trying to give it some air. He's giving it some air, not trying. He's giving it, he's airing it out for us. And we need to, you know, get used to that, get used to it. Now, it can be condensed. We're condensing it right now, very intensely condensing it. And this is what I've always wanted. In a spiritual culture, you get this condensed. There's teachers who teach in this condensed way, and you can hear that, and that really saves you so much struggle, you know, so much. So ultimately, from A Course in Miracles, from Jesus, will come this apostolic dispensation where we have it very condensed and we can practice in this very condensed way, and we accept the shock of this, and this really saves us from so much misery, actually. The kingdom of now begins to dawn upon us very, very, without much delay at all. And what is that dawning? It's our preparation. We're giving this preparation to ourselves. We call it the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is really our true nature, our true self. So we're giving this to ourselves, the dawning, this preparation for the kingdom of now. So the kingdom of now begins to dawn upon us. We begin to abide in it. And the voice of the arrogance is just now incredibly muted, so muted. It's like a distant, faint echo that doesn't really interest us at all. So this is just wow, full stop in the wow mode here. When we go quiet, that's full stop. That means that we're in full stop in the wow mode. next gives you an opportunity to just assess the reverberation. Not assess it, but just be aware of it. And just say, wow, this is really powerful. You may feel sleepy, you may feel like, I can hardly, it's just almost knocking me out. Yeah, it almost knocks us out. Yes, I don't have anything. Now, when Jesus spoke to the rich young prince of the Decapolis, east of the Sea of Galilee area, Decapolis means 10 cities, which was settled by the Greeks, actually, that area. Alexander the Great, after he divided his kingdom up, after he passed on, and then among his generals, that area got settled. It's still places like Amman, Jordan, and it's the Jordan area, like that east of the Sea of Galilee, and Damascus is actually part of that Decapolis. So Jesus said, he asked, what do I need to do to, you know, be truly happier? What do I need to do? Jesus says, sell everything, give everything away, so you don't have anything, you know, and follow me. Now, this was a spiritual advice for a type of practice, actually. See, Jesus was really introducing right practice to us. And we took it too literally. We've taken it too literally. He didn't mean for this person to necessarily cast off their life, their livelihood, and everything. He was talking about this practice that we can do. I still have a job, you know. I still have just a, you know, householder, you know. I have everything that most people have, so to speak, just as a householder. I can practice right here, right now, Saturday morning. What he means is practice saying, I don't have anything. Say to yourself, I don't have anything. I don't have any achievements. I don't have any treasure. I don't have any success. He meant give up all these concepts. Practice releasing these concepts. This is what he was talking about. So the Bible really is this encodement of these practices in the form of these stories. Now, did any of this ever happen? There's no reason why it couldn't. Did someone just make up all this to encode all these practices in a story about Jesus? Well, it's possible, but there's no reason why it couldn't have happened, that Jesus couldn't have come here and couldn't have met with these people and said this like a play, you see. The people back then viewed things in terms of like parables and plays and this kind of, you know, way. Dramas and so, but he was really coding into our consciousness these practices that we're now directly aware of. You see, we're directly doing the practices that Jesus suggested to us so long ago in a very oblique, indirect way, that, you know, into the fabric of our living in this form of stories. You know, the Beatitudes, blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall inherit the kingdom. You know, this is a practice he's talking about. He's not saying that you're supposed to be defeated and depressed and I'm poor in spirit or anything like that. No, he's saying, give up these concepts of success. I don't have any success. Because we've given a new purpose to the dream. That's why he said, I'm a New Testament. He's saying, I have given this dream of preparing for the kingdom of time a new purpose. Preparing for the kingdom of now, kingdom of heaven, kingdom of now. I've given a new purpose. You can give it a new purpose. A new testament. A new testament. New purpose. He says the old purpose, Mosaic law and all that, the law, is to prepare for the kingdom of time. He says, I did not come here to help you prepare for the kingdom of time. I'm here to prepare for the eternal life. Okay, preparing for the kingdom of now, of I am, isness. And you can do that because this is a dream. So all this that was encoded into our beingness, our consciousness, psyche, in the forms of these allegories, parables, stories, things like that. But our challenge is to get it, get to the actual direct practice, instead of just continuing to blah, 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 and keep taking it literally and missing the essence of it. Jesus said, when you find the pearl of great price, go sell everything else, all your jewelry. Same thing, what is he saying? Give up all accomplishments. I don't have any accomplishments. I don't have any attainments. This is our jewelry. The pearl of great price is this perfect support of the preparation for the kingdom of now. Different, change the purpose of the dream, and we get this pearl of the great price, this ultimate jewel of perfect support. So we don't need all this jewelry of attainment and accomplishment and success. An arrival, and answers. We don't need any answers. We don't need any results. This is what he's saying. This is what the life, he's saying, give up this life. He who would try to find this life shall lose it. But he who would lose his life, let go of his life, shall attain, have eternal life. Exactly what he's saying. What he said then, but now he's returned and said, okay, let's get to the practice now. Now it's time to start practicing. Let's stop. Let's, you know, we've had this vagueness, you know, okay, to help us, but now it's time to get to the direct practice of what I really was getting at. What I was really getting at was your need to practice. So really, if Jesus 2,000 years ago could have come in and said, hey, everybody, you really need to practice, and here are the practices, but people were not ready for that. They were not ready for that directness. We were still obsessing about, well, how are we going to fit into the kingdom of time? What kind of rules and regulations do we need to follow? And, you know, Jesus broke some of those rules and regulations. They got so mad at him. They said, how dare you, you know? We need these for to fit into the kingdom of time. But Jesus was showing us this, you know, that's not important. When in Rome, do as the Romans do. So don't be a revolutionary or iconoclast or anything. Just let that just be as it is. But practice, practice, practice these practices that I'm suggesting to you. See, we've taken our arrogance to be our identity. And so we think our identity is very displeased with us. We need to please our identity by accomplishment and achievement and stuff. That's not, arrogance is not our identity. But what is arrogance? But to assume that it is our identity, right? To assume a false identity is arrogance. For arrogance, arrogance's very nature is to say that arrogance is our true identity. That is arrogance. So you don't have arrogance without the assumption of a false identity. That arrogance is our identity. Arrogance says, "Hey, I'm your true identity. The other one was false, was arrogant." That's what arrogance says. Your true identity, oh, that was just arrogance. I'm your true identity. And you need to get ready for time. You need to prepare for time, because that's the kingdom I'm going to give you. It's my gift for you. Like, this world's like some kind of gift for to us, you know. So keep in mind that what really Jesus told us to do is practice. Immerse yourself in practice. So don't try to translate this into the non-practicing understanding of what Jesus said. It doesn't work, because that is still trying to prepare for time. We just think that, well, Jesus gave us some way that we can successfully prepare for time. We just don't quite understand. No, that's not true. There isn't any way to successfully prepare for time, because time doesn't exist. We'll never come to a point where we say, well, if time did exist, you know, this is how, you know, we could dwell in time successfully. Well, you can never get to that. This is all an aimless wandering around with no meaning whatsoever. There's no way you can establish levels of meaning within illusions at all. So we can never reach some grand scheme of arrangement. I have no arrangements whatsoever. There's another A. I have no arrangements whatsoever. I don't have any arrangements. I don't have any plans whatsoever. I'm completely free of any plans. I'm completely free of any arrangements. I have no accomplishments. I have no success. I have no attainments. I have nowhere to arrive. I haven't arrived anywhere. I don't have any results. I've never produced any results. I've never been successful in any way. Now, this is all true, isn't it? There's no order of meaning among illusions. There's no order of meaning concerning what is more like time and what is less like time. There isn't no such thing as time. So how can we say something is more like what doesn't exist? Something is less like what doesn't exist. Zero is like 10 more like zero than 6? Or like there's 3/4, you know, more like zero than 5/8? There's no number that is more like zero. You know, 1 and a trillion have no resemblance to zero whatsoever. You can't compare it at all to zero. So we keep doing this relative comparison of illusions, like, well, yeah, like so maybe 8 is more like 0 than 10, maybe 3 is more like 0 than 8, or maybe 777 is more like 0 than 666, or, you know, we make all these comparisons like numbers of illusions, but there isn't any comparison you can make to what doesn't exist. Comparison is impossible. So I don't have any answers. See, I don't have any answers. We could say to keep conceptual for we could say the answer is, there is no answer. I don't have any answers. My answer is, I don't have any answers. But that answer really refers to a different purpose for the dream. Because if we didn't have a different purpose for the dream, this would seem like nonsense. So the ego said, well, this is nonsense. What do you mean the answer is, I don't have any answers? How does that get you to attainment? How does that teach you anything about how to, how does that compare with time? You know, time. How do we, how is that closer to the kingdom of time? I mean, where does that get us? So I say, I haven't gotten anywhere. There's another assertion we can say. Yes, I know. I haven't gotten anywhere. I absolutely haven't gotten anywhere. I've made no progress whatsoever. I've never had any progress at all. I've never made any progress. I've never gotten anywhere. See, now this does not refer to preparing for time. Ultimately, it refers to preparing for no time. You see? And saying, I haven't gotten anywhere, is a perfect statement of no time, right? That time will never start. So I say, that's great. How wonderful. I haven't gotten anywhere. That's exactly what you'd expect if there isn't, if time is never to start at all. So we're not attacking the old purpose. We're affirming the new purpose. And this the ego doesn't understand. It sees only one purpose for the dream. Because arrogance said, well, that's what I set it for. And I can't, since I'm the new God, the new, I'm your true identity, you can't change this. But arrogance is not our true identity. So we can change the purpose. So we can assert this new purpose. I've never gotten anywhere at all. Yes, I'm not getting anywhere. Yes, I'm not experiencing any success. I've never gone anywhere. Yes, I'm not going anywhere. I'm not getting any, I'm not making any progress whatsoever. Yes, I am not making any progress whatsoever. I am resting in no progress at all. I'm resting in not getting anywhere at all. I'm resting in the peace of that. So the ego cannot, arrogance cannot accept this or understand it or relate to it, because it cannot accept that a new purpose can be given to this dream. It cannot. Arrogance cannot do that. So the ego can never agree with what we're saying. But we can. We can say, I don't have any agreements. I've never made any agreement whatsoever. I've never done anything. I've never gone anywhere. I've never gotten anywhere. I don't have any agreement. I've never made any agreement. Again, this is practicing, this is preparation for the kingdom of now. And the ego cannot, has no role in this. It cannot accept that we can give this dream a different purpose. It cannot. And still maintain that it is, has any identity whatsoever. That arrogance has any identity whatsoever. It cannot do it. So all I can do is compare. Well, is one closer to zero than eight? You know, and practice it. I think I'm closer. But we practice this. There is no closeness. I don't have any closeness whatsoever. I've never been close. I never got anywhere. I've never been close. The ego loves this idea of getting close or getting somewhere. But in our practice, now we understand that what we're doing is we're evaporating our continuity fear, and this gradually happens, and we're gradually getting used to, familiar with the truth. Now, we can call this getting somewhere or progress or closeness, but it's not in the same purpose or context that the ego's talking about it. So for the purpose of practicing, we're setting down the ego's purpose, okay, the purpose of arrogance for this dream. As we set it down, we pick up this new purpose for the dream. So we practice saying, I've never gotten anywhere. I've never made any agreement at all. I don't have any agreements. I've never made any progress at all. I don't have any progress. I'm unaware of any progress whatsoever. I don't have any progress. I've never gone anywhere. I've never done anything. I've never succeeded at all. I don't have any success. I don't have any answers. Again, very intense progress, but the option to this is to go with the egoic intensity of trying to prepare us for the start of time. And you will find that intensity is a wretched, wretched thing for you, for anyone. Massively inflated egos and arrogance here in the world. Massively inflated entitlements, belief in attainments, and all of this stuff. Arrogance just saying, yes, I have attained this. Yeah. So we're saying, I haven't attained anything. I'm completely without any attainment whatsoever. I have no attainment. And we can get comfortable and familiar with this. And then what occurs, the kingdom of the now begins to dawn upon us. The kingdom of I am begins to dawn upon us as preparation to set down all preparation. As perception to set down all perception. I don't have any attainment. I have no answers. I've never gotten anywhere. I've never done anything. I have never done anything. See, this one hits real hard. I'm just searching for what hits real hard. And this is the benefit of the practice, is someone who's willing to search for this and you know, what really hits hard, and then you know, say, I have never done anything. Not as a statement about the ego's purpose or anything, but as a way of practicing this new purpose. Where I'm perfectly supported from the get-go. So I've never done anything. I've never done anything. The ego thinks we're attacking it and tries to draw us into guilt about attacking it. We're not attacking the ego. We're just giving a different purpose to the dream. Now the ego claims that this is attacking the ego. It's not. What is the ego but arrogance, insisting that arrogance is the new identity? Arrogance has never been an identity. So how can we be attacking arrogance as identity? We cannot. It doesn't have an identity. We're just reaffirming our true identity is all we're doing. I have never done anything. I have never done anything. There's nothing that I can do. There's nothing that I can do. I've never done anything. There's nothing that I can do. I've never had any attainment. There's nothing to attain. There's nothing to attain. I've never had any attainment. There's nothing to attain. I've never done anything. I've never gotten anywhere. I've never had any success. Yes, I've never had any success. This is the happy confession of one who is the dawn of the kingdom of now, who's preparing for the kingdom of now. This is a happy confession. We're not like grim and saying, oh, this is terrible. Say, no, this is great. This is great. I'm seeing, wow, there's nothing to attain. I don't have any attainments. I don't have nothing to accomplish. I don't have any accomplishments. Nowhere to go. I haven't gone anywhere. Nothing to get. I haven't gotten anything. Instead of saying, I don't get it. How come I don't get it? And say, no, I've never gotten anything. I've never got it. I've never got it. And of course, there's nothing to get. I've never got it. Which is a statement is, in the kingdom of now, there's nothing to get. I already have everything. Pure potential. So I've never got anything. I've never gotten it. So turn this negativity that we're feeling, like, wow, I just don't get it. Say, yes. I don't get it, and I've never gotten it, and there's nothing to get. I'll never get it. I'll never get anything. Yes, I'll never get anything. How wonderful. I'll never get anything. I don't understand at all. I don't have any understanding. I don't have any understanding whatsoever. I'll never understand. That's right. I'll never understand. I don't have any understanding. I'll never understand. I've never understood anything. I have never understood anything. I've never had any success. I never will have any success. Again, the ego cannot understand this practice at all. It cannot accept it. You know, we can practice. I've never accepted anything. I'll never accept anything whatsoever. I don't have any understanding. I don't have any acceptance. Now, obviously, arrogance cannot practice this way. Therefore, we are practicing it this way. Therefore, we must not be arrogance. You see, our identity must not be arrogant. Cannot be. Arrogance cannot practice this way. You can try to take drugs to try to simulate this and claim it can practice this way. But this is quite different than taking drugs, isn't it? We're doing this in a positive, celebratory, affirming, asserting with clarity and poise. You know, there's no drugs here. The ego tries to fake it. That, oh yeah, I can do that too. But I need a lot of drugs to do that. And then, of course, when the drugs wear off, you know, the practice is gone. And the arrogance says, see, I did it. Just trying to prove it can do it. But we say, I've never done anything. I've never done anything. And I never will do anything. I never will do anything. I never will have any attainments. I'll never have any accomplishments. So arrogance is behind all the drug use in the world. Okay, 100%. Spirit never, our true identity never tells us to take drugs. So when you see this world becoming a drug planet, pharmaceutical drug planet, which is what it's happening, this is all arrogance. All arrogance. Arrogance trying to compete with our true identity, claiming, no. Whatever our true identity can do, I can do better. You see this attitude of arrogance infesting the people of this world. It's this, whatever you can do, I can do better. even though I've had no, you know, have shown no ability really to do it. Whatever you can do, I can do better. It's just arrogance, just as asserting, well, I can do better. I can do this. Whatever you can do, I can do. Oh, you can be enlightened. Well, you can be, quote unquote, enlightened. Oh, I can do that too. With this arrogance talking. And then it says, well, we use drugs, sex, drugs, rock and roll. Just insist that you know, it's just I'm enlightened, so therefore, that's it. Arrogance just states it, I'm enlightened, and you have to accept it. That's arrogance. But arrogance cannot do this kind of practicing that we're doing. And it's not doing it, is it? If you look in the world, do you see this being practiced? You do not. This is a condemnation of arrogance, okay? Arrogance isn't practicing the right way because it can't. So those who are following the advice of arrogance, they're not practicing in the right way. They're going towards sex, drugs, and rock and roll as fast as possible. Paying lip service to you know, spiritual teaching. Oh, yeah, I read that book. Oh, yeah, Course in Miracles. Oh, yeah, I've heard of that. Yeah, yeah, but no worries. We can do the same thing here with sex, drugs, and rock and roll, which requires glamorizing the body, which requires attracting to the body. That's why you see those who are experts at glamorizing, attracting the body. Those are the ones who are popping up like mushrooms everywhere. You know, every day, you know, you see all these new people you've never seen before. And they're all, you know, they're all glamorized out, and they're saying, "Look at me! Look how wonderful you are! Look how what arrogance can do for you! Look what it's done for me!" And they're the ones that are now singing the song of salvation, based on arrogance to the world, and saying, you know, listen to this song. But right practice is, you know, those who believe that arrogance is their identity cannot do right practice. They can read about it, they can think about it, but they can't do it. They cannot do it. It cannot be done through arrogance. Now, when we're setting our arrogance down, we can do it gently. So we get better and better at this practice as we set our arrogance down. The more we do with this practice, the easier it is to set our arrogance down. Doing this practice is setting our arrogance down, actually. See, thinking about it isn't setting it down. But actually practicing is setting it down. This just like evaporates arrogance. It just evaporates it. Of course, arrogance claims it's not doing anything. Said, no. I don't even have to try. Everything's the same as before. I'm not making any change. It's making massive changes, frantically, putting these glamour cheerleaders in place, the cheerleaders of glamour, and of sex, drugs, rock and roll, and of arrogance. Frantically putting those in place, and all the while claiming, no, I'm not doing anything. I'm not doing anything, because you see, we're just saying, I don't have to do anything. And literally, I don't have to do anything. Except to practice the realization I don't need to do anything. I don't need any realization. Obviously, we have a continuity fear, so we do need to practice. But that's all we need to do, really. And so arrogance say, wait a minute, I have to not do anything also. But on the other hand, it's like frantically changing society, engineering society, and all the while claiming it's not doing anything. And there's this vicious war against religion, and all the while arrogance is saying it's not doing what? I'm not doing anything. I don't have to do anything. So arrogance is trying to pretend that its spirit doesn't have to do anything. All is perfect, but all the while mounting a massive blitzkrieg and campaign. You know, it's completely insane, you know, arrogance. And people are just jumping through hoops. I mean, it's just, it's entertaining in a certain way. You know, reading all these apologetics, there's a massive army of apologetics for arrogance that say, well, what are you talking about? War on religion. Nobody's saying anything. You're making this up. You know, well, what about this law? Says, they go back to arrogance. What should I say here? You're crazy. You're a nut job. What are you talking about? You know, you're the one who's warring on us, you know. But they just, it's just, it's entertainment. It's entertaining. But it's also not very helpful. You know, it's like an absurd farce. If you watch a movie, it's an absurd farce. It's hard to stop watching because really you don't know what's going to happen next exactly. I mean, it's sort of... all these people frantically trying to attain and accomplish and achieve, and they're saying, no, I'm not doing anything. I'm not trying to do anything. Nothing's happening. I'm not doing it. You know? And saying, I'm enlightened too, you see. I know. I'm not doing anything, and yet I'm frantically trying to do all this stuff. And you point it out, and they say, no, I'm not doing that. You must not be seeing properly. No, you must be crazy. I'm not... Me? Nothing's happening. We're not doing anything. We don't need to do anything. Arrogance doesn't need to do anything. What do you mean we're preparing for time to start? We don't have to make any preparations. So they desperately try to dress in the drag of spirituality, you know. And it's, you know, that's part of farces, where people try to dress up as something, someone they're not, and yet the dress is sloppy, and you can obviously... They're not who they're pretending to be, and that's part of the whole, you know, interest in farces. We miss these farcical movies. You know, those are about the only movies maybe worth watching. Is if you have some brilliant, I don't know if there are any brilliant producers of a wonderful farce where, you know, everybody is trying to pretend to be someone they're not, and yet to the viewer, you can see, you know, like, hey, wait a minute, they're just pretending, and yet the act. Those in the movie, you know, they're so busy trying to pretend that they're someone they're not, that they can't see that someone else is. But occasionally they might say, wait a minute, you know. It's like and so we should not argue see, don't get involved in arguing with arrogance, this bizarre masquerade, because it has no choice but to strive and claim it's not striving, to frantically re-engineer society and then claim it's not doing anything at all, and that anyone who says must be completely insane, or worse, evil, wicked, bigoted, prejudiced, intolerant. Sexist, racist, you know, the arrogance, just whatever, you know, if someone points out, well, wait a minute, it said nobody can do this now, you just passed this law that nobody can do this, so we have to completely change our behavior, and Eric says, no, what are you talking about? You must be racist or something. it diverts and accuses you of something terrible, you know, that it thinks it's terrible, because it feels... It's being accused of something terrible, and it feels guilty. But it's, wait a minute, I'm arrogance. I'm truth. Truth is whatever I say it is. So I say, no, I'm not doing this. You're the one who's bad, and you have to, you know, be punished for this. This is your just punishments or something. It's just a bizarre absurdity. This culture, this world is just a madcap farce that. It's better than any movie could be made, actually. We don't need a movie, farcical movie. This world is the ultimate farce. You know, the gyrations of arrogance are just, you know, it's too much. I mean, it's too funny. So you have like a garbage man, a sanitation engineer. Not wonderful people, but just for example of this, who wants to win the love of a princess, and so he dresses up as a count. He says, how do I act like a count, you know, and tries to figure that out. And then he sees this princess, and he says, wow, let me try to win the hand of this princess. So he tries to impress the princess, and lo and behold, the princess is impressed, and he says, wow, you know, maybe I really am a prince, you know, or a count or something. And what he doesn't realize is that the princess is actually a washerwoman who wants to win the hand of a prince who's pretending to be a princess or a countess, you know. And so she's trying to figure out how can I be a princess? And, you know, and viewing it, we're saying, wait a minute, that's hilarious. And neither one knows that the other one's trying to impersonate, you know. And she says, oh, here's this prince that is interested in me. This is amazing. This must be effective, what I'm doing. This prince is effective in me. And the garbage sanitation engineer is saying, wow, here's this princess that's interested in me. I must really be a prince. What I'm doing is so effective. This is amazing. And so they both conclude that they must be a prince and princess. And they go along and introduce themselves to society. And just, you know, people are saying, what? Huh. And yet they believe it so strongly that the real princes and princesses start doubting themselves, saying, are they really princes and princesses? And maybe we're not who we think we are. Maybe we're the ones who are blemished, you know, don't know what we're doing. And so gradually, you know, the whole kingdom starts crumbling because this washerwoman and a sanitation engineer were so convinced that they'd convinced someone else that they were prince and princess that the others started doubting themselves. This is like arrogance, okay? The arrogance is so strong that truth starts, you know, doubting itself, saying, wait a minute, you know. Maybe this is what we need to be doing. Maybe we need to prepare for time. Maybe arrogance is our true identity, and the true identity was just arrogance, you know. It gets flip-flopped like that. And so at the end of the movie, you have all these princesses and princes, and the princesses are now washerwomen, you know, and the princes are now sanitation engineers, and they're ruled over by this king and queen now. The whole kingdom has been turned into a dump, you know, and they're all thinking, wow, we finally got it. I don't know what we were thinking about before, you know, crazy, must have been crazy. Late but worth the wait here on the garbage collection. So we're all slumming in this dream of arrogance, thinking, oh, we're really getting it. We almost got it. But now what we're practicing, I've never gotten anything. There's nothing to get. I haven't gotten anything. I'll never get it. There's nothing to get. I don't get it. I've never gotten it. So we're all in this dream of arrogance. We're thinking that, oh, we're really getting there. I say, no, I haven't gotten anywhere. We're practicing, I haven't gotten anywhere. But this is really a statement of changed purpose, right? Freedom from the old purpose of arrogance. believing that arrogance is going to be able to create a new kingdom, kingdom of time. How can arrogance say that it could create a new kingdom better than God's if arrogance goes along with the same kingdom of God, which is perfect freedom? How is that proving anything? It's not. So arrogance has to believe in some different creation, different kingdom, and the only way it could be is a kingdom of time. Either we're free or there's time, one or the other. So it believes that it can create a kingdom of time. And so it's just preparing us for that kingdom of time. And that eventually we'll get it. We'll finally, you know, have enough succeed in this preparation. And yet, we know that arrogance is just an idea, a foolish whim that we had. And so we know that we're really the ones that are dreaming the dream. So we can change the purpose of the dream. We don't have to get the permission of arrogance at all. Absolutely not. We don't have to go to arrogance and say, "Arrogance, look what I've attained. I'm enlightened, so I can have a different purpose, right? Or I've reached this attainment, or I've been successful. I get it. I've succeeded. I finally arrived. I finally recognize. I'm finally aware." We don't have to go ask for permission from arrogance to change the purpose of the dream. So we say, "I don't have any attainment. I don't need any attainment. I don't have any attainment. I don't need any attainment. There's nothing to attain. I don't have any accomplishments. I don't need any accomplishments. There's nothing to accomplish. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created spirit to be." So you don't go to arrogance for permission. This is so important. This is why so many don't start practicing. Is they say, "Well, I haven't got permission yet from quote-unquote God. My inner God, a God of arrogance. I haven't got permission yet. It doesn't think I'm ready yet. I'm not ready. I don't have any readiness. I'm completely free of readiness. I don't have any readiness whatsoever. I have no answers. I've never done anything. And I'm not ready at all." Okay, this is hitting real hard now. We got to this readiness factor. Arrogance always insists you need to be ready. And he says, "You're not quite ready." And you just say, "Okay, but since we've given the dream a new, we have faith, we have given, we can and given the dream a new purpose. We don't need any readiness for time. I don't need readiness. I don't have any readiness. I've never been ready. I've never been ready. I have no readiness at all. I don't need any readiness." I have no readiness whatsoever. So we've touched on this readiness factor. This was a very hit a nerve there. I'm not ready. I've never been ready. I don't have any readiness. I don't have any readiness. I don't have any achievements. I don't have any readiness. Again, this one is almost knocking me out. So you must be aware of the wow factor, otherwise you might take it as disinterest. Like, oh, I'm losing effectiveness. I'm losing interest. It's not a matter of losing interest. It's the shock of success that you're experiencing. So if you just stay patient with this, you'll come out of it. And then you say, wow, I survived it. Where if you don't have this full stop in the wow recognition, you'll think you're losing interest. You're going to sleep, I'm losing interest, oh, I might as well quit, you know, I don't have any. No, that's the mistake we make. It's not that I'm not ready, I don't have any readiness. There's nothing to get ready for. How can I have any readiness? There's nothing to get ready for. I don't have any readiness. I've never had any readiness. I've never been ready. This is one of ego arrogance's most vitally important defenses, is this idea of being ready. Wow. It's very hard. I don't have any readiness whatsoever. I have no accomplishments. I have no achievements. I have no readiness. I have no answers. I've never gotten anywhere. I've never done anything. All said positively, yes. Yes, I don't have any readiness. Absolutely, I don't have any readiness. I'm completely free of all readiness. can't give a full opportunity for the wow. These are the most intense practices we've done, and I've rarely, if ever, come across any practices that are any more intense, if ever, really. So certainly give ourselves the benefit of the doubt here, and allow the wow to, or allow ourselves to adjust to this, you know, give it a little adjustment opportunity here for adjustment. Get used to it, opportunity to get used to it. Just to see that you survived this. I said, wow, I've never gotten anything. I've never gotten it. I've never done anything. Wow. I can survive. I can say this and survive. You know, this is like, wow. The arrogance tells us if we ever say that, we'll die. Arrogance. All its deepest defense is it claims if we ever free ourselves, we're going to die. You know, it tells us this. Well, how can we die? We're in charge of the dream. We give it a different purpose. We can still have a appearance in that new purpose. Even if it's it can be a body. It can be a light body. It can be a lightened up body. What dies is death. The idea that somehow arrogance has capacity to inflict death upon us does not. Now, when you're a young child, you may come with all this confidence and feel happy and not awkward and everything, but and you don't know how to really express it or explain it to the adults, so they just think, oh, you're just a child, everything's fine. And then when you try to explain to them, they just say, oh, you're just the awkwardness of youth, you don't really, can't express yourself well. So for a while, you have this grace period where everybody just says, oh, they'll grow up, they'll grow out of this, no problem. But then when you start being able to explain what truth here, then they start saying, oh my God, this is horrible. What are you talking about? You're crazy. You're on the wrong track. You know, get back under the spell of arrogance. You know, you don't have an identity. That's not the identity. That's the old arrogant identity you have. And we have a new identity. The arrogance is our new identity. And now the old one is now arrogant. You know, they don't understand. So, but the more clearly you can express yourself, the more shock the adults get here, the ones under the spell of arrogance. And that's when you then suddenly say, oh my gosh, everybody hates me. They think I'm crazy. Wow, it's frightening. You know, they get to freak out. I don't have any doubts either. I don't have any doubts at all. I have no doubts whatsoever. I don't get it. There's nothing to get. I've never gotten it at all. And I have no doubts. I have no doubts. What is there to doubt? How can I have doubts? There's nothing to doubt. What is there to doubt? Of course, we're preparing, you know, for the kingdom of now. So that's the premise. So we're being absolutely accurate and sane with our premise. The arrogance keeps saying, wait a minute, you're contradicting your basic premise, because it thinks that its premise is our basic premise, because it insisted that it is. But so it doesn't, it can only be confused and be upset. But what we're saying isn't totally in line with our premise. What is there to doubt? There's nothing to doubt. I don't have any doubts. I'm perfectly supported by the kingdom of now. And this is not something attained or accomplished or recognized. It's simply, I don't even have to recognize it. It's intrinsically there. Doesn't require my recognition for it to be there. It's intrinsically there. And it allows me to know that it's there. I don't have to use the accomplishment of recognition or the accomplishment of some awareness to be aware of it, to experience it, to know it, experience it, to perceive it. At this point, it's perceiving, so. So we have completely turned everything right side up again. I don't have any doubts. I've never got. I don't understand it. I don't understand it. I have no understanding whatsoever. There you go. I have no doubts, and I have no understanding. If you can stand this, where are we at here? I think we're almost finished here, aren't we? Let me see. No. Okay, we have a little time. Great. Great. I don't understand at all. I have no understanding whatsoever. I have no understanding. So you can see how it is. There's another thing. Seeing. I don't see anything. I can't see at all. I don't see anything. There's nothing to see. There's nothing to understand. I don't understand. I don't see. But we can recognize whatever word we want to use. It can be turned into a practice. That those who keep thinking that arrogance is their identity, they can't practice this way. It would draw tremendous conflict and confusion and upset and feeling that they're being tricked or mocked or something, you know. They're not able to. So you can judge a world based on, you know, where's the world at in terms of arrogance? You know, how much right practice is there? You know, if you want to test, you want to test yourself out, you know, just test yourself out like this. So that's, I'm testing myself. In doing this, saying, wow, yeah, I love this. This is great. This is what I've always wanted to do. I don't understand anything. I've never understood anything. I don't have any understanding. And instead of going into this struggle with arrogance and trying to justify and gain its approval for what we said. Instead of that, we just celebrate in the wow. Like, wow. My identity can't be arrogance, right? Otherwise, I couldn't assert this in a positive way and go with it. So, every time we make an assertion like this, every time we practice, we're really getting used to the fact that arrogance is not our identity. And getting used to our true identity. Without arguing with arrogance one bit. Don't struggle with the struggle. Arrogance is saying, I need to struggle with this. Wow, this is a struggle. Don't struggle with it. Just instead say, no, this is a very positive wow I'm feeling. Don't try to explain anything to arrogance. I don't understand anything. I've never understood anything. I've never gotten anywhere. I have no doubts whatsoever. No doubts. I have absolute certainty. Or you could turn it around the other way, couldn't you? You could say, I have no certainty whatsoever. I've never had any certainty. And this would then help us disengage from arrogance, right? We could practice. There's two different ways. You can assert a positive, or you can assert the negative, like I don't have any certitude at all. Meaning certitude as an attainment, you see. This is what we're saying. I don't have any attainments, including certitude. I've never attained any certitude. I'm trying to prepare for time, so I don't have any certainty. So practice is just simply whatever's effective, whatever hits that nerve, whatever, you know, evaporates this continuity fear, then this is being effective for us. I have no certainty whatsoever. I've never had any certainty. You see, we don't need certainty, because there is no doubt. As I said before, there's no doubt. I don't have any doubt, but we don't need certainty because there is no doubt. It just is. I am. There's no thought about certainty. So we're dropping our thoughts and our concepts here, getting past our thoughts and concepts, and especially all the ones that have to do with attainment. Those are the ones that you know, have tricked us. So I've never gotten anywhere. I've never done anything. Never understood. There's nothing that I've ever understood. I've never had any understanding whatsoever. I've never had any deal whatsoever. No understanding. Never had any understanding. But don't say this as if you're complaining. Say it in yes. I've never had any understanding. Like, great. Yes, I already know that I've never had any understanding. And smile. Say it positive. And like, yes. Yes, yes, yes. This is great. You know. I've never had any understanding. And of course, we're referring this to a new purpose of the dream, which is now the only purpose that we give to the dream. So we say that this has always been the purpose now. This has always been our purpose. It extends. It's timeless. It extends. So, nothing to understand. I've never had any certainty. I've never had any understanding. Don't need any understanding. Don't need any certainty. It just simply is. No attainments are needed. I don't have any attainments whatsoever. I don't have any needs. I've never had any needs. I've never had any needs. See, by saying that, we're recognizing that this whole dream of preparing for time was completely aimless and meaningless from the very beginning. So it's like as if it never was. So we're now talking about this new purpose, which is preparing for the kingdom of now, which does have an aim. And so we can say, within this context, I've never had any needs. I've never had any desires. I've never had any understanding. I don't need understanding. I've never had any attainments. I've never had any accomplishments. I've never gotten anywhere. I don't need to get anywhere. This truth is true everywhere. Truth is true everywhere. There's nowhere I need to get to be more righteous. Nothing. I don't need to do anything. Nothing that I can do that will improve upon my position of not even needing a position of I am-ness. I am-isness. So again, this is the wows. It keeps coming back. It keeps coming back. It keeps coming back because we're practicing. That's what we should do. I don't have any wisdom. I don't have any wisdom at all. I don't have any enlightenment. I don't have any wisdom. I don't have any success. I don't have a place. I've never had a place. I don't have any place. I've never had a place. Okay, there's another one. I don't have a place. I've never had a place. I'll never have a place. I'll never have a place. Of course, what we have is everywhere. It's not a place. So, I'll never have a place. I don't have a place. Get used to this. Except, wow, yes. I know I don't have a place. Yes, I know I've never had a place. Yes, I don't have any security. I know I've never had any security. Yes, I know I'll never have any security, as it were, security. Because and now, how can there be any insecurity? There's no concept of security at all. Hummingbird. I think. No, maybe not. No, just a little bird. I don't have any place. I've never had any place. I don't have any understanding. I've never had any understanding. Okay, we're getting towards the end of this. So you can see the intensity of this. If you know, so surviving, just say, wow. This is staying one step ahead of the madness, of the insanity, of this arrogance, as it attempts to make its, you know, dominion over us permanent, you know, instead of just a silly dream. It's it thinks it has the ways and the means now. See, it's very confident that it has the ways and the means. It'll develop an app for that, you know. So we finally have this app that now will establish arrogance as our true identity. And all you need is that app. Just download it here. And you're good to go. So everyone's saying, oh, that's great. Pretty soon we'll finally realize that arrogance is our true identity. And time will start. Once we accept that completely and embrace it, time will start. And we'll finally...